Yes.
Uh-huh. I was down to my last time. What Jesus stepped in right on time. I sure been sick.
House of the Lord. Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. We praise God for another day, another opportunity to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I offer these words of greeting as we begin our time of worship this morning. For that love which began before creation flows in and through you this day. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're blessed to have Sister Angeline as our worship leader this morning. Please receive her once again by saying amen.
Amen.
Praise God for God's presence with us.
Prepare your heart and spirit to receive
God's mercy and healing.
We thank God for God's mercy toward us.
Come, let us praise and worship God, who's always with us.
Thanks be to God at all times and in all places.
Amen. We'll have praise and worship by the sanctuary singers, so I'll tell you not to sit because we're going to worship God today.
Testing.
When I'm broken, strength where I've been weak, and forever He reigns. My God is awesome. My God is awesome. Is awesome, Savior of the whole world, giver of salvation, by His stripes I am healed. My God is awesome, today I am forgiven, the stress is why I'm living, praise His holy name. My God is awesome.
He's holy, awesome.
He's awesome,
awesome,
yes,
I feel like praising for him. I feel like praising. I feel like
praising the Lord. Let us quiet our hearts and help me with the opening prayer. Gracious God, we come this day seeking courage and hope for the future. Our world is in such a peril. Heal these wounds and quiet the words of war. Help us to be those who bring peace in our families and communities. Banish the darkness of doubt and fear. Anoint us with your light and the love that we may spread the good news of your mercy to everyone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll have another song of worship from the Sanctuary Singers.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
The scripture lesson is taken from Romans 12, verses 1 through 8, and will be read by Reverend Davidson.
Once again, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8, the New Revised Standard Version reads, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, on the basis of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable act of worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members and not all the members have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ. And individually, we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministering. The teacher in teaching. The encourager in encouragement. The giver in sincerity. The leader in diligence. The compassionate in cheerfulness. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
We'll have a musical selection from the sanctuary singer, and then this will be led to the sermon, Our Reasonable Worship, by Reverend Davidson.
Belongs to you, all the glory belongs to you, O God. All the glory belongs to you, all the glory belongs to you, O God. Sing high. belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you, all the glory belongs to you, oh God. All the glory belongs to you.
Amen. All the glory, all the honor, all of the praise belongs to you, oh God. Amen. 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 Let us praise God for our sanctuary singers this morning. Amen. Amen. Let us join our hearts in prayer. God Almighty, you are good and your mercies endure forever. We are so grateful once again for this time to gather for worship. We are thankful for your goodness towards us, your mercies and your grace. Even now, as we share together, prepare to share in this your word, I pray, God, that your still speaking voice would continue to speak to our hearts, God, that we will know without a doubt that you are God and there is none other, that we will know without a doubt your love for us is unfailing, unconditional, and immeasurable, that we will know, oh God, that your grace is sufficient to meet us in our time of need, Lord God, and that we will find the grace to run on the race that is set before us. Lead us and guide us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 This morning, I will reflect with you, share with you from the subject, our reasonable worship, our reasonable worship. In our scripture this morning, the Apostle Paul writes to the church at Rome, a church he did not plant, nor had he yet had a chance to visit. Paul had been teaching about sin, that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and about our need for salvation, that in spite of our rebellion against God, God's grace abounded, that God loved each of us enough to send Jesus Christ, his Son, into the world, who, while we were yet weak, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I'm walking through the book of Romans, if you don't know yet, as we say in our communion liturgy, which is taken from Romans, this is proof of God's love toward us. Paul goes on to teach, we have peace with God. We have freedom from sin. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Paul continues to exhort the church, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He lets them know that they are sons and daughters of God, that nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. He goes on to tell them that no matter what they face, they are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Here in Romans chapter 12, one of the most well-known verses in Paul's writing, he continues, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service or your reasonable worship. He uses an image of an offering before the altar of the temple to suggest that we as Christians are to be sanctified, consecrated, set apart for God's purposes, not only spiritually, but our physical bodies are to worship God as well. It's a book that I've used for new disciples class, or as I'm learning, we call it adult confirmation class here. The book I've used is A Blueprint for Discipleship. In it, it talks about our Christian witness being strengthened when we're able not only to talk the talk, when we know what we're supposed to believe as Christians and believe it, but when we're also able to walk the walk, when our beliefs translate into transformed lives, living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul begs the church at Rome, I beseech you, as brothers and sisters, to let your life, how you live, to be holy, to be righteous, to be acceptable to God. This is not asking too much when you consider what Jesus Christ has done for you. When you think about the nails in his hands and his feet, when you think about his side being pierced, when you think about the crown of thorns on his head, when you think about all that Jesus has done for you, this is reasonable worship. Pursuing holiness, meaning right relationship with God and one another, is a reasonable worship. Living in a way that is pleasing to the Lord is our reasonable worship. Paul says worship is more than what we do when we come to church on Sunday morning. I enjoy singing with the sanctuary singers. Amen. I enjoy praising God. I enjoy praying with you all. God is good. But when we leave this place, our lives are to be lived in worship to the Lord as well. Paul says in verse 2, be not conform to this world. In other letters, Paul suggests that we are sojourners just passing through this world. That since this world is not our ultimate destination, that we should not accommodate ourselves to the customs or the practices or the values that are contrary to the kingdom of God. That we are ultimately citizens of God's kingdom. Amen. And so we are seeking to follow God's will above all, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and perfect, that acceptable will of God. I learned in seminary that the life of faith is a dance between orthodoxy and orthopraxis. Orthodoxy meaning right belief, and orthopraxis meaning right action. When we have orthodoxy, when we have right understanding of our faith, are you following me, church? Then we have an opportunity to reflect on it, to learn about our faith and reflect on it. And then we go out and live out our faith. That's the orthopraxis, so that we can live faithfully. And after we've gone out and tried to live our faith, sometimes we get it right and sometimes we get it wrong. And so we come back to church and we come back to Bible study and we come back to discuss with our brothers and sisters in Christ in prayer meeting what it means to live out our faith and how we can be strengthened so that when we leave and we go back into the world, we can live out our faith in Jesus Christ. What are you saying, Reverend? I'm saying being transformed by the renewing of our minds is not a one-time thing. It's a spiritual practice that Paul is speaking of that is a process. That's why the early Methodists held class meetings each week, and they would come together and share their challenges about living out the Christian faith, and they received instruction and they received encouragement, and sometimes they received rebuke, but they also received it in love. Amen. Elsewhere, Paul says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, or and I'll add as a woman, amen, I put away childish things. As we grow, as we mature in our faith, as we grow in our knowledge of God, as we grow spiritually, we grow in our ability to discern the difference between right and wrong. We grow in our ability to understand what is pleasing to God and to live in a way that demonstrates, that provides an example to others of what it means to follow Jesus Christ. And so Paul continues that you may prove, that you may show, that you may exemplify what is the good and acceptable will of God. That you may discern, amen, what is God's will. We don't always know what God's will is, but as we study and as we grow and as we seek God's face, we learn and we mature and we are able to live into who God is calling us to be. If you'll keep walking with me through this text, verse 3 in Romans chapter 12, Paul encourages the church not to think more highly of themselves than they ought to think. He says, do not be puffed up thinking that you can do no wrong. Amen. Acknowledge that each of us has imperfections, that each of us has limitations, that we all miss the mark sometimes. As I read this text, I'm also reading it with a word of caution for us, that this is not a call for us to have low self-esteem, amen? That this is not an excuse for a lack of self-love, that we are called to love our neighbors as ourselves. And this is not to discourage anyone from reaching for the stars or being all that you can be. Those of you who have studied biblical interpretation, you'll know there's something called hermeneutics when we study the Bible, how to interpret the Bible, and there's ways in which we have to be cautious about reading texts, like don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to, in a way that can be abusive, amen? When Paul says this, as people of African descent, we are to be careful not to have this used in a way that calls us to be put in your place. You stay in your place right there. Too many of us have stories of those who have told us that what we couldn't do, what we were not capable of, when we knew that we could and we knew that we were capable. Amen. And so as we hear this text, we also want to be intentional about encouraging our young people to achieve greater than even we did, to achieve the greatest that they can. Just as Jesus says to his disciples, even greater things will you do than I have done in my name. Instead of being afraid that somebody's going to think you have a big head, I want to encourage you boldly to let your light shine. Amen. Let the light of Jesus Christ shine through you. Be the best you that you can be, bringing glory to God. Perhaps as we read Paul's words in verse 3 once again, he's saying to us that it's still important for us to acknowledge our growing edges. That we know, when we know what our growing edges are, we can bring them before God in prayer. God, I'm struggling in this area of my life. We can ask God to sanctify us. We can ask God to make us more like Jesus in those areas. And we can also find those who will support us in our lives. Amen? Amen? Paul then says, we are one body with many members. We are one body, the Church of Jesus Christ. We are Methodists, we are Baptists, we are Presbyterian, Pentecostal, Seventh-day Adventist, Lutheran, Episcopal, Roman Catholic, UCC, non-denominational, Nazarene, Apostolic. Did I leave out any? Nonetheless, we are one body in Christ Jesus. Even if we see things differently with regards to baptism or who can be ordained or what day is the Sabbath or what the style of worship should be or what gifts of the Spirit should be exercised in worship or who should receive Holy Communion and how or who can be saved or what it means to live faithfully and a whole host of other theological questions. And in spite of all of this, these differences, we are one body in Christ Jesus. We are called not to think more highly of ourselves collectively, right? Our particular piece of the body of Christ, our particular denomination, our church, we're not called to think more highly of ourselves than others. This means that we see through a glass dimly. We see from our own perspective. We do not always see the whole picture. There's a story told of a few persons who wanted to know what an animal was. It was a huge animal, an elephant standing in front of them. They were blindfolded and one touched the trunk and felt the trunk and says, oh, this is what the elephant is like. Another grabbed the tail and felt the tail and said, this is what an elephant is like. Another grabbed the leg and felt it and said, this is what an elephant is like. Another grabbed the tusk of the elephant and felt the smoothness of it and said, this is what an elephant is like. Another touched the side of the elephant and felt how broad and how high it went up and thought, this is what an elephant is. But none of them had the full picture of what the animal looked like, because from their vantage point, that is all that they saw. So it is with us in the body of Christ. We may see things differently about what it means to be a Christian, about what it means to be a part of Christ's body, but Paul encourages us to be humble. And there's a difference between humility and humiliation. Amen? It's not about putting others down. It's about you knowing that while you might know a lot, you don't know it all. Amen? That while your church might be awesome and there might be some things we can learn from others as well. But perhaps the diversity of the body of Christ is by God's design. That different churches serve different populations, different demographics, people at different places on their spiritual journey, differing needs for an emphasis on personal piety, for example, or social holiness, or caring for the least of these. The Apostle Paul says, not all members have the same function. We who are many, there are a whole lot of churches in the city of Hartford, amen? We who are many are one body in Christ. There are a whole lot of members, even in North United Methodist Church. I'm told we have something like 500 members on our rolls. We are many, but we are one body in Christ. A human body has different members that serve different functions. Our toes, while they do keep us standing and help us to walk, cannot do all of the things that our fingers can. Our legs, they help us stand and run the race that we have to run, but they serve a function that the hair cannot. Our noses have a different function than our mouths or our ears, that while all parts of the body allow us to do different things, one should not be thought to be more important than the other. We honor the strengths of each member of our physical body without there being any competition between them. And in the same way, we as a church of Jesus Christ, we honor one another. Amen. We celebrate the gifts that each of us brings to the table, not expecting everyone to be the same. Not everyone in the pews will be able to sing like the sanctuary singers, but some of y'all can cook some jerk. This I know. Some of you can cook some barbecue ribs, some escovitch fish, some roti. Hallelujah to the Lord Jesus Christ. I got me some good sorrel and some sour sap juice. God is good. Some of y'all have our organizational geniuses who know how to bring order out of chaos. Some of you have the gift of encouragement with your sense of humor and your kind words. You're able to lift up spirits of those who are downhearted. Some of you are gifted with the ability to offer care for those who need it. Some of you are gifted leaders and visionaries. These gifts that we have received from God are by God's grace. And they are expressed so beautifully in our lives, so differently. Paul, he lists in Romans chapter 12 some of these gifts, but I need to note for you that it is not exhaustive, and there are other lists in his writings. Here he lifts up the gift of prophecy in proportion to faith, that is preaching, proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ, not necessarily predicting or foretelling the future. He lifts up ministry, in ministry, taking care of the needs of others. He lifts up teaching, in teaching, using the scriptures, or as we as good Methodists, we have the Wesleyan quadrilateral, the Bible, tradition, experience, and reason to teach others what it means to be a faithful Christian. He lifts up here exhortation in exhorting, encouraging others to follow the way of Jesus Christ. He lifts up giving, generosity, generosity, sharing what God has given to us, graciously being kind to others. Paul lifts up here the gift of leadership, leading with diligence, compassion, being cheerful and caring for those who are sick or those who are homebound or those who need your assistance. Whatever gift God has given you, may you know them as a blessing in your life and not a burden. Amen, somebody? Whatever gifts that God has given you, receive them as an expression of God's love for you and for others. And so as you share the gifts that God has given you, God didn't give it to you to keep it all to yourself. Amen. God loves you and God gave you those gifts, but God wants you to share them. So as you share them, as you minister, as you serve, as you teach, as you encourage, as you share generously, as you lead, as you share in acts of kindness, may it be the love of God that has been poured out in your life, overflowing into the lives of others. May it be effortless that as the gift God has given you and shared with others, that they will know the wideness of God's mercy and the heights and the depths of God's love for them. As you share the gifts God has given you, may you also experience the love of God for you in your life. In order for our physical bodies to function optimally, our body parts need to work together. Amen? And so it is in the body of Christ. We need the members of the body to work together, benefiting one another. The body of Christ is at its best when we bring the best of who we are, when we bring the gifts that God has given us and share them with others, share them with the world. So this afternoon, we are going to share in a harvest festival, a harvest, a celebration, symbolically bringing the first fruits of the harvest, honoring God with our best. But this morning, I hope that you will consider the Apostle Paul's words, that we are not only to worship God with the offerings that we give financially in worship, but our reasonable worship is how we live our lives. Amen? Amen. I have asked the ushers to hand out to you a survey. I'm going to ask them to come at this time. This is a survey. Amen. Amen. And so as our ushers come, ask somebody to share some with our members who are upstairs. What I'm going to invite you to do is consider the gifts that God has placed within you and to consider that it is your reasonable worship to worship God with your gifts. Amen. And so rather than Pastor Davidson calling you and saying, can you serve on the finance committee and you don't do well with numbers? Or asking you, can you sing in the choir and you only make a joyful noise to God in the shower? I want to invite you, you can go ahead and pass them out now. I want to invite you to consider how the Holy Spirit is calling you to share the gifts that God has given you. Everybody knows they've got gifts, right? Everybody knows they've got abilities, they've got skills, they've got the ability just to share a kind word of encouragement. We all have something that we can do in worship of the Lord, and it is not too much for God to ask of us that we would share the gifts that God has given to us. So as you receive this survey, it's called Serving in Community Survey. Consider how you might share your gifts in worship, caring for others, welcoming or doing outreach and evangelism, communicating the gospel of Jesus Christ in different ways, doing children or youth ministry. On the back page is adult education there, ministries of justice and mercy and love, how we can care for the house of the Lord, how we can care for the church's finances and be good stewards, and how we can partner with those who serve on staff in the church to do the work God has called us to do. We can't do all of these things, amen? But there's one thing at least that we can do, and if it's not listed here, then you can write it in. There's a spot that God is calling you. Do something else there. You can write it in that you sense that God is calling us as a church to begin moving and working in this area. So if you don't have a pen, you might turn to a neighbor and ask them to use theirs, but I want you to take a moment at this time. And this is the invitation to discipleship this morning. Amen. How is it that we might worship God with the gifts that God has given to us? For this is our reasonable worship. As you fill out these forms, I'm going to ask Brother Balaam to lead us in a song. Yes, your name up top. We can check if it's a new ministry and put a star if you're already serving in that ministry.
My soul says yes, 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 my Lord, my soul says yes, 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 yes. My soul says yes, 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 my Lord, my soul says yes, yes, yes. Do you will it? Yes.
Opportunity to turn those in during the time for offering or at the end of worship. So let us prepare our hearts to go before the throne of grace. Eternal God, our Savior, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy towards us. And so we say yes, Lord God, to your will and to your way. Thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity even to come together and share in this your word. And we pray, God, your blessings now upon each one that has is prayerfully considering how you're calling them to serve. I pray, Lord God, that you would reveal to us the gifts that we have, oh God, those that we might not have thought that were gifts, but others appreciate, Lord God. Help us to serve you in the ways that you are calling us to serve. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ for each one gathered here and each one who is worshiping with us online in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord God, that your blessings would be upon our lives. I pray, Lord God, where there is need, that you would provide for your children's needs according to your riches and glory. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would remove everything that is an impediment to us following your way and following your will. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would remove temptation, that you would remove doubt, God, that you would remove the hand of the tempter, Lord God, that you would allow us to experience victory in Jesus' name. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord God, that you would heal those, oh God, who stand in need of your healing in mind, body, and or spirit. In the name of Jesus, we believe, Lord God, that you are Jehovah Rapha, God, our healer. And so we trust you with our lives today. Have your way within us, we pray in Jesus' name. We pray together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Will the ushers come forward? While they come down, just imagine if you all just mark one box to volunteer on that form, how powerful we can have ministries in North. So I urge you, just like Pastor, pray on it and check a box. God will guide. Let us pray. These offerings we present to you, O Lord. May they be used for your ministries of love and reconciliation through this community of faith. Amen. Please come forward for tithes and offering. For the doxology. Yeah.
You may be seated.
It's from the Sanctuary Singers, and then we'll have the benediction.
I just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. I just wanna praise you forever,
forever,
and ever,
and ever,
and ever,
and ever.
To walk away from the darkness into the light, go into the world confident in Christ's love and God's eternal presence with you, go to be witnesses for good and a bearer of peace to all you meet. Go in peace. Amen. Amen. God bless you.